Welcome back, Daily Caller. I am senior White House correspondent Christian Daytalk. I'm sitting down today with Jeff DeWitt, former NASA CFO and a senior advisor to the Trump reelection campaign. Jeff, thanks for joining me.
Thank you, Christian. Thanks for having me.
We're going to be talking about Saturday's historic launch, but before we begin, I want to remind all of our viewers to hit subscribe, hit the bell to get notified every time one of these interviews goes live. We'll get to Saturday in a second, Jeff, but before we begin, obviously the nation is dealing with tremendous unrest at the moment. What's your take on these protests that have really swept across the nation and in some cases have been hijacked by people who aren't necessarily out there protesting police brutality?
You know, it's obviously a sad state of affairs, and it's certainly not, I don't think it's having the intended intended result that the protesters say they want. You know, the whole event was unfortunate with George Floyd and everything that happened, but now how it's going down, obviously not a good thing for the country. It's not a good thing for their message, certainly. I don't know how, you know, stealing Apple iPhones and Rolex watches is helping anybody send any kind of a positive message. So, you know, it needs to stop. And certainly there needs to be a dialogue in this country about the best way to move forward. But the current state of affairs is not helping their cause, and it's not the way to get it done.
I couldn't agree with you more. Let's turn to a slightly more positive subject. Obviously, Saturday's historic launch was a long time coming. We've all seen the SpaceX videos of their launch and their return of the Dragon rocket that they have. What do you think this means for NASA, considering we haven't, as a country, officially sent men into space, or women for that matter, as a part of an official NASA launch in nearly a decade?
Correct. And this, the message that was sent on Saturday is that NASA is back. I was so proud to be the CFO of NASA for just under 2 years, serving under President Trump and Vice President Pence. And there is no question that this administration has put NASA back on the map. It was a big push by the president and the vice president to do this again, and to involve the private sector and involve the commercial sector. So if you notice, that launch on Saturday was a commercial rocket, and you saw the SpaceX branding on one side and you saw NASA on the other. So instead of this being completely government-owned, government-operated through NASA as in the past, we are now involving the private sector, which is allowing us to go further and farther and faster than ever before. But this was the first time since the cancellation of the space shuttle in 2011 that we have launched humans, Americans, American astronauts from American soil on American rockets. So what an exciting time. And this was just the first. The future is very, very bright for the country and for NASA and for human exploration of space. And what you saw Saturday was just the first. So what a great thing. And full credit has to go to President Trump and Vice President Pence for the amazing support this administration has given to NASA.
In terms of next steps, obviously President Trump has started Space Force. That's not a branch under NASA, but they are obviously related. He's talked about colonizing Mars, revisiting the moon. Even President Obama, before they closed the manned flight program, mostly because of the previous fiscal recession, talked about, you know, colonizing Mars. What do you think is a next realistic step in terms of the manned flight program?
Well, what you're going to see is you're going to see the first American woman on the surface of the moon in about 5 years. This was a project started solely by President Trump and Vice President Pence. You know, one of the first orders of business when this administration took over was to reconstitute Space Council, of which Vice President Pence is the chair, and Space Policy Directive 1, the very first order from the Space Council, was get back to the moon. So what you're going to see now is a return to the moon, the first, again, American female astronaut on the surface of the moon. And that is going to be proving the technology that it's going to take to get back to Mars. So while previous presidents have talked about Mars, no one has ever actually done anything about it. There's been no formulative plan or funding until right now. This administration is the first one to actually put meat on the bones and give us the resources we need to get there. So truly, when we go back to Mars, it's going to be this administration, or we get to Mars, not go back to Mars, when we go back to the moon and get to Mars, right, it's this administration that absolutely deserves the credit, and I saw it firsthand for years at NASA.
Let's talk about that corporate logo on the side of the rocket. Obviously, this was just a bit as big of a day for SpaceX as it was for NASA. How do you see the public-private partnership expanding in the future when it comes to space travel?
You're going to see a drastic expansion of public-private partnerships. This was just the tip of the iceberg. This is the very beginning. Mm-hmm. But what you're going to see when we go back to the moon is you're going to see private companies build every piece, almost every piece of getting back there besides one of our main rockets, the SLS. But the landers that we're going to land on the moon with humans in, you saw Elon Musk, a billionaire with SpaceX. Don't forget, Jeff Bezos has Blue Origin, his own company.
Right.
You're going to see them involved with the landers. So every step of the process now, we're involving private companies. And pretty soon, I would say within the next year, Boeing is also launching. They're going to have their own private. In addition to not only privatizing what we're doing, we're making it competitive. So you see SpaceX and Boeing, we have two providers that are going to be doing the same thing. There is a possible third waiting in the wings. Boeing and SpaceX have capsules like you just saw over the weekend. There's a company called Sierra Nevada Corporation building what's called Dream Chaser, which is basically a new and improved space shuttle. It's got wings. It can land on a runway. A lot of benefits to that as a delivery method for human beings and for science and the ways to get it back. You get it back faster and at low Gs. And theoretically, the space shuttle itself, we needed very, very long runways. It was a limited amount of places we can land. With Dream Chaser coming up, that can actually land at any runway over 10,000 feet. Theoretically, that can land at San Francisco International. So you could land a lot more places, at Dulles. So a lot more options are opening up. You're going to see a lot of exciting things coming up that are a result of the great guidance of this administration that you've never seen before. So what you saw hopefully should wet the whistle of every American, but even more exciting things are coming.
So obviously, we can't wait to see some of those more exciting things, but this isn't your main job now. You're working hand in hand with the Trump campaign. Obviously, you've only been there since around February or so. So you really jumped into this thing at a very unprecedented moment, both for modern politics and presidential races. What do you think the largest hurdle towards the president getting reelected is as it stands today?
To be honest, I don't know. There's obviously a lot of things come into play. Mm-hmm. I think the largest hurdle that the president has is he has a lot of members of the media, and I'm not including you in this, of course, but there are a lot of the media outlets that seemed to be giving the other side unlimited resources from the networks to try to hurt the president. Mm-hmm. And I've seen it firsthand. When the president talks about fake news, I've seen it firsthand. I've been in some meetings that the press then later says something or something happened or something was said. And we all look around and say, well, that didn't happen. We were there. So the whole use of unnamed sources and things is a way they're just that the media is doing what they want to do to shape the message. So I think that, but the president does have a hard time getting the truthful message out. And you see that get played out. But outside of that, look, I worked with the president on the previous campaign. I was the COO and CFO of the 2016 campaign.
Right.
And I just know how important it is to get this administration reelected. To get President Trump reelected is very important for our country. So for me to get to come back and help again is something I'm honored to do. And I really think it means everything to what we're doing. Don't forget, this president did build, until the coronavirus hit, he built the greatest economy our country's ever seen, with the lowest unemployment on record across the board for every minority, the lowest unemployment record. So the highest employment, I should say, to say it in a positive way. So this administration has done a great job. I was so proud to serve again for a couple years in this administration at NASA, and I got to see the great work they do. I think people would be really, really surprised to see how much in the details President Trump is in overseeing and making sure that good things are happening. It's really impressive, and getting to work with him on both sides of this has been a joy, and it's very impressive to see. He's very good at what he does, and I really hope he gets a chance to do four more years so we can see our country become even greater, and this administration can do that. Vice President Pence as well, what a wonderful guy who's working so hard to make things better all across the board. I got to see that from NASA's end, but I also got to see it from other agencies' perspectives. They're doing a great job in really doing what America needs. So You know, it's a great chance for me now to help the cause and keep him there. So really enjoyed my time and now I'm just going to work, as you said, I'm proud to be an advisor back to the campaign.
You just touched on coronavirus, and obviously the pandemic threw a wrench in both the president's plans for campaigning as well as former Vice President Joe Biden's. Do you see the Trump campaign, now that states are starting to reopen, returning to some of those big public events that made him so popular back during the 2016 campaign effort?
Oh, I don't see any way that the campaign will not go back to big events. Obviously, it's a hallmark of this campaign. You know, what's really impressive is when you notice that probably, especially even these days, the people that can get inside these massive venues are about 1/4 to 1/3 of the people that show up. Usually outside, there are twice as many to three times as many people outside that just can't get in because of a lack of space. The president can fill the biggest venues in the world. And so we're going to go back to that because there's no better way to get the message across. And when you look at the other side of the aisle, there's a reason that the Democrats aren't booking these big venues because they can't fill them at all. And that's what really tells you that President Trump has a lot of momentum. When you see the enthusiasm and the size of the crowds that he draws versus what the Democrats draw, it's very little comparison. And if you ever saw a Democrat draw a crowd like that, maybe I think they'd have a better shot at winning elections. But as of right now, they don't have it. And there's a reason, because a lot of people, again, fervently support President Trump and want to see. They know that a businessman in office who's not a politician, who never was a politician before this, still is the best person for the job of driving the economy and bringing jobs to this country. So he's doing a great job of that, and that's what we want to see more of.
All right, Jeff. Well, I want to thank you again for joining us today. I'm looking forward to picking up this conversation in the future and talking about the next steps that NASA and the U.S. government is taking towards sending us back into the stars. Have a great one, my friend.
You too. Thank you very much.
And to all of our viewers out there, if you haven't already, hit subscribe, hit the bell to get notified every time one of these interviews goes live. I'm Christian Daytalk. We'll see you next time.